in the headlines to the CBC NewsNight. A move is on to bring order to the PSV sector. After months of environmental problems, Lawrence Tigay is back to full readiness. The national nutrition policy for schools rolled out. And in sports, both Bajan Chelseas move on to round two at the Pan Am Surfing Games.
Broadcasting from our studios in the Pine, St. Michael, this is CBC NewsNight, starting now.
Good evening and welcome to the CBC NewsNight. I'm Wendy Burke. A major push is on to control what is seen as chaos in the public service vehicle sector. The first step was taken today in the House of Assembly as members started debate on the Transport Authority Amendment Bill 2023. Our Ryan Broom joins us live now with the details. Ryan.
Good evening, Wendy. Well, what has triggered debate on this piece of legislation has been described as the absence of a proper regulatory framework of enforcement for the PSV sector. And according to Acting Prime Minister and Minister of Transport, Works and Water Resources, Santia Bradshaw, it has resulted in a minority of operators becoming nuisances to society. She says government is serious about bringing order back to the roads. Minister Bradshaw says complaints have been made, including from tourists. She stresses that while government understands the vital role of the PSV sector, there must be compliance with the rules and regulations.
I am happy that the amendment is here today, but I am also somewhat concerned that it has taken almost 15 years for the respective entities to reach a point where they were able to bring this level of clarity and strengthening of the Transport Authority to fruition. Let me just say that the Act seeks to make it very clear in terms of this particular amendment as to the fact that not only can the Transport Authority issue the permit, but the Transport Authority can also revoke, suspend, and cancel the permit now which it has issued. The difficulty before was that having not issued the permit, but only providing an approval letter, one cannot therefore revoke that which one has not given.
Ms. Bradshaw also wants owners and operators to adhere to the rule relating to the display of vital information of the PSV owner and insurance provider.
We need to ensure that within the vehicle that there is prominently displayed who is the owner, who is the insurance company, and the contact information as well for the insurance company, sir. It cannot be that owners themselves take a hands-off approach and that they are not brought within some level of responsibility in relation to these regulations. And I can go further, sir, and we will go further. But the truth of the matter is this is not about picking on one individual or entity over the other. This must be seen as an issue of safety that is affecting our country and an indiscipline that is creeping into the country that we need to stem.
Ms. Bradshaw also disclosed that the Ministries of Education and Transport are exploring numerous ideas to ease traffic congestion associated with back to school. Measures include acquiring more buses, among other things.
We've said we're going to bring the 10 buses by the end of this year. We also have another 21 being ordered to be able to complement the existing fleet of the electric buses. Myself and the Honorable Minister of Education have been in discussions regarding dedicated fleets for schools to be able to try to improve the transportation of school children to and from school, looking at staggered hours, trying to see if we can have extended hours after school so that we can ease the pressure of some of the traffic that is currently on our roads as well.
Meanwhile, St. Thomas MP Cynthia Ford is fed up with the ZR culture and wants to see the new amendments to the Transport Authority Bill implemented in short order. She says ZR drivers break too many laws daily, including going off route, playing loud music, and driving recklessly.
Some mornings in the quiet village where I live, I would rather hear my dog and hear the sheep and the goats, and people shout for me. I walk in, prah, 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 from Sturgis Corner. It comes over through my head, so at least you can hear it. All through the vault road, the dirty lyrics and the music, for what? I know that the system was there where guys were sent to court, and the court system has things clogged up, and some of them have 50 and 30 reports.
And Ms. Ford also spoke about her near-death encounter with a reckless PSV driver.
I almost lost my life in Jackson. Coming down from the hill by town, the van had in about 60 Leicester Vaughan school children, and the rain had fallen where the water was all over the road and in the gutter. And the man was doing the milkshake. Mr. Speaker, not the thing you drink, or it couldn't be that. But you are doing milkshake with people's children in there. And I reported it to the police too.
And St. Michael's South Central Parliamentary Representative Marsha Cattle believes the Transport Authority Amendment Bill will not only improve transport operations, but it will bring several benefits for other sectors. She made the point during her contribution to today's sitting.
We are not just here on this occasion, sir, to stop a man from driving, although we want that, or to make sure that vehicles are in good order on the road. We are here, potentially in this sector, to reduce our reliance on fossil fuels, to ease traffic congestion, to cause people to have greater income streams, to cause people's small businesses to be more productive. It don't seem like that's what we're doing with this little amendment, but that's what we potentially can do. To cause people to increase their productivity at work, and overall to increase people's well-being.
And of course, Wendy, that bill was eventually passed. It's back to you.
Thank you, Ryan. And with us now is the Director of Public Communications and Public Affairs at the Alliance Owners of Public Transport, Mark Haynes. Good evening to you, Mr. Haynes.
Yes, good evening, Wendy. How are you?
I am well. Now, the bill has been passed. How does that feel for you all in the sector?
Well, this is long in coming. We are glad that the requisite legislation is now put in place to control the disorder which is on the roads of Barbados. This cannot continue for an inordinate period. It has gone on now almost four decades, and it lends itself basically to anarchy, it will lead itself or has lent itself to anarchy. We cannot have a system that continues unabated. So it is unfortunate that the government had to go the legislative route in order to bring order on the roads of Barbados. But for this, we are glad. But what it underscores the point that the owners of the vehicles now have to take charge of their investment. So it is therefore imperative that they make a concerted effort to ensure that they do employ the rightful persons to ride their vehicles. The recklessness, the lawlessness, the bad behavior, behavior, of course, that is very unsavory, is unacceptable. We have listened to the commuters, we have listened to the general public, we have listened to Barbados. We are convinced that those, what has been said against the PSV fraternity, that those things are true. Suffice it to say that not a large number of persons are doing it. There are a few guys in the system whose behavior is not of the best, and they have caused and are causing confusion for the sector. So now that the requisite mechanisms are in place in terms of the regulations. Mm-hmm. Now the Transport Authority now has the legal right to act according to law and to prosecute whomever. So it makes sense going forward that the workers now pull up their socks, stop the foolishness, cut out the bad behavior, which cannot continue. It is untenable, and we are all for it. So with this, we commend the government for having taken the initiative in this regard. I think it was a question of the lack of political will to bring the regulations. This government has undertaken to use its will to bring the requisite regulations.
Okay, I just want to know quickly before we go, in terms of your hiring practices going forward now as owners, given what can happen to you, what are you looking to change?
Well, you know how to vet people very carefully, because it comes back very much to the owner of the vehicle. Let me use the singular person here. The owner of the vehicle now has to take charge more so than ever. It underscores this point. So he or she has to ensure that he or she employs the rightful person in order to play his or her vehicle. Because at the end of the day, it is his or her investment, not the operator. And therefore, the owner must take charge more. So I urge the owners to ensure that this happens, and they have to make an effort to improve.
Okay.
Because we don't want to run foul of the law.
Okay, thank you so much for joining us this evening, Mr. Haynes.
Yes, thanks for having me, Wendy, and I appreciate it very much.
Coming up, the news turn begins with an environmentally troubled school back to full readiness. After months of disruptions due to a persistent odor, the Lawrence T. Gay Memorial School reopened its doors to all students from today. Over the past two terms, the school has been holding classes at four different locations as officials work to determine the source of the problem. Shirika Griffith visited the school and filed this report.
For the first time in months, classes for the more than 380 students of the Lawrence T. Gay Memorial School are being held in the same location. When a CBC team visited the Spooners Hill Institution, there was no obvious trace of the persistent odor, which officials have been trying to determine the source of since last October. Chief Education Officer Dr. Ramona Archer Bradshaw, who was on hand for morning assembly, says the decision to return to the campus was based on the results of several tests undertaken. These included ensuring wells were sealed, that there was no leakage of gas from septic tanks, and air quality tests.
After analyzing all of those results, we made the decision that the teachers and the students could come back to the plant, given that all of the findings indicated that there is nothing in the atmosphere at the LTG Memorial Primary School at present that could be hazardous to the health.
Dr. Archer Bradshaw is, however, giving the assurance that the Ministry of Education stands ready to respond should the environmental issue return.
Given that the school is embedded in a community, there is no telling when a type of odor could be detected by staff members and our students. So what we as a ministry will do is that we will continue to monitor the situation, and if there is any incidents of the odor being detected on the compound again, we'll make sure to make contact with our air quality specialists, who will come at the same time to determine the link or the correlation between the odor that is detected by the staff members and our students and what actually exists in the atmosphere at the time.
Principal Brent Blackett says he's comfortable with the results of the test conducted and was happy to have the full student body back at the school.
The children seem to be very happy to be back at school. From the response I got this morning, they are happy, and my staff is generally happy to be back as well. Let me say for my part that I have not had any experiences, you know, I've not experienced the odor. So we'll wait and see, because now that the plant will be running at full capacity, we will see if any issues arise. But nonetheless, we know that we have the backing of the Ministry of Education, and we will be monitoring the situation closely.
Mr. Blackett confirms the attendance on day one of the Trinity term for both teachers and students was high. Shirika Griffith, CBC News.
Today also marks the rollout of the National Nutrition Policy for schools. Acceptable snacks and beverages are those that contain between 130 and 240 milligrams of salt and no more than 25 grams of total sugars in snacks, and no added sugars for beverages. However, several parents were observed purchasing snacks no longer considered acceptable from nearby vendors. CBC spoke with one vendor who has been plying her trade from the school for over 30 years. While she is willing to comply with the policy, the woman who preferred not to give her name says past efforts to offer healthier snacks for sale did not go well.
Try already, but they never buy, like, I had apples, grapes, different fruits, and they never buy none. I had eaten them. Charity begins from at home. If you got your children, you don't get the fruits for early, you pass them to them, it's obviously hard to come and buy them and eat them. You don't understand? Parents just go and say, not only grand from me, I see them and tell them shopping and snacks, they buy the snacks, carry home for the children. So after practice, the children into them, so all the things, they're going to look hard for them. You understand?
Chief Education Officer Dr. Ramona Archer Bradshaw is urging parents to work with the ministry to ensure students consume healthier foods. Dr. Archer Bradshaw was asked about penalties for those who flout the policy. She says those students who bring snacks and beverages considered unhealthy will be reminded of the policy by teachers.
We are using moral suasion right now. We are not talking penalties. You know, if it is not followed, the bad result will be that we end up possibly with a population 20, 30 years down the road that will not be able to contribute to the positive national development of Barbados. So the onus is on everyone to do what they have to do to play their part to ensure that we secure our future.
This just in, the national diagnostic testing is to get underway across the island as the Ministry of Education seeks to understand the level of learning loss due to the COVID-19 pandemic. According to the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development Report 2021, lockdowns resulted in 1.5 billion students across 188 countries being unable to attend school in person, causing lasting effects on the education of an entire generation to this end. The Ministry of Education, Technological and Vocational Training will be administering diagnostic assessments to second, third, and fourth form students across public secondary schools. This from Minister of Education, Technological and Vocational Training, Kay McConney.
Our Ministry of Education has an increasing concern that some students have not yet mastered fundamental concepts and are having difficulty with their social and emotional interactions in ways that are impacting the entire school community. We have to respond. And as such, the Ministry of Education, Technological and Vocational Training has committed to conducting national diagnostic assessments to determine student mastery of existing content areas as identified in the national curriculum. At this time, the assessments will cover literacy, numeracy, and social and emotional learning.
The Ministry of Education will be working with students, teachers, and parents to develop intervention strategies tailored to students' needs.
A meeting will be held with parents using the Zoom and the YouTube platforms tomorrow, April 26 at 6 p.m. We're asking all parents to show up and to please check your emails where your school notifications normally come. During this meeting, the following will be discussed. One, the rationale for the diagnostic test. Why are we doing this? Why is it necessary? How will it help? The content, what would be included? Administration, how will it be administered? Who will administer? Data collection and analysis, what will be collected? How will it be analyzed? How will it be protected? And the way forward.
One day after water prohibition went into effect, rainy weather has caused flooding in some areas on the island. The northern part of the country was particularly affected, with a section of Church Street in Spikestown transformed into a river through which motorists had to carefully navigate. The watery street forced most vehicles to reduce their speed to a crawl. Over in St. Thomas, not far from the parish church, the heavy rain created slippery driving conditions, and at least one motorist was involved in an accident when he lost control of his vehicle. It's unclear at this time if any injuries were sustained. The Barbados Meteorological Services has forecast that wet conditions are expected across the island until Thursday. The prediction was made last Sunday, 2 days after government announced a water prohibition that took effect on Monday. 17 Barbadians have reached the pinnacle of the world's leading achievement award for young people. The recipients of the Duke of Edinburgh's Gold Award were presented with their certificates by President Her Excellency the Most Honorable Dame Sandra Mason during a ceremony at State House. Participants are required to choose a voluntary service, a skill, and some form of physical recreation, and commit to the chosen activity for at least 12 months. In addition, they must train for and complete an adventurous journey in unfamiliar territory for at least 4 days. Chairman of the Awards Board of Trustees, Sir Trevor Carmichael, says the group is one of the largest cohort of gold awardees.
It's one of our larger numbers, and that augurs well for the future of the award. We are seeing more and more students becoming increasingly interested in not only joining the award, but in going through all of the paces, the bronze, the silver, and the gold. And each one of these carries an expedition, each stage. And the expedition alone is something which is a test of mental and physical fortitude. So when I see a student has reached the gold, there's something special about that.
Sir Trevor says the program has been successful in many countries, including lowering the recidivism rates when it was introduced in prisons in South Africa. CBC spoke with some of the awardees, all young people in their 20s, about their experience in the program.
It is hard at some points because you are thrown in scenarios and situations in as a part of the Duke of Edinburgh that you have to have some critical thinking skills. You have to be able to have a lot of patience with other people as you have to work together with the team. So it was really trying, but it was a really fun experience. You get to meet a lot of people. You get to learn a lot of new things, and it basically grows your character. You become a leader, independent. It's very good.
My favorite part of it is that it gives you a sense of ownership for what you do, and it lets you, even at a young age where you're not in control of so many things, this is something you are in control of, because for majority of the aspects of the program you have to complete, you decide what you want to do. You decide your volunteer service, you decide your skills, you decide how far you want to go in the program.
I did my gold award in 2017, went to Ghana and traveled 500 miles south of Georgetown, and it was amazing to say the least. My most memorable experience was summiting Turtle Mountain because the landscape was absolutely beautiful. It was next to me to give back. See, the award gave to me, the award developed me, and all I intend to do for now is to give back.
Singer, actor, and activist Harry Belafonte has died at the age of 96. The cause of death was congestive heart failure. Belafonte, born in 1927 in working-class Harlem, New York, spent 8 years of his childhood in his parents' native Jamaica. He was dubbed the King of Calypso after the groundbreaking success of his 1956 hit, the banana boat song, Deo. He also became a movie star after acting in the film adaptation of the Broadway musical, Carmen Jones. His biggest contributions, however, took place offstage. He was a key strategist, fundraiser, and mediator for the civil rights movement. And news of Belafonte's passing triggered memories for many here in Barbados as they recalled his role in a movie shot on island. He starred in Island in the Sun movie, which was filmed at Farley Hill. He played the character David Boyer, a black labor leader who was vying for political office against a rich landowner's son. Apart from contentious elections, there were several scandals to go around. Belafonte also worked with the late Irvin Burgee on numerous songs throughout his career.
Sports Night, brought to you with the compliments of Great Health Works, agents for Omega XL.
Sports time now with Anne-Marie Burke.
Good evening to you, Wendy. We start with news of surfing. Both Chelsea Roy and Chelsea Tuak have advanced to the second round of the women's shortboard competition at the ongoing Pan American Surfing Championships in Santa Catalina, Panama. Roy won her heat with a wave total of 8.7 points after securing a major wave with just about 3 minutes left in the heat. This is what she had to say after her win.
What are you doing? How's the spirit?
It's really good. We're actually one of the smaller teams here, so we're very close-knit, and we're all staying in the same place, and we're all eating dinner together and just enjoying Panama and the heat. It's really hot here, but, you know, it's a different kind of heat to Barbados, but all in all, it's been really good.
Do you want to say hi to someone at home?
Yes, hello to my family, and feliz cumpleaños to my dad. Love you guys.
Thank you, Chelsea.
Meanwhile, Tuak was second in her heat. She led up until the final 2 minutes before Argentina's Lucy Duran picked up a late wave to gain a total of 11.17 to Tuak's 10.11. The second round is scheduled for Friday. Tomorrow, the men's shortboard will see Jacob Burke, Shea Allen, Josh Burke, and Kai St. George in action in the opening round. Yesterday, St. George advanced to round two of the boys' longboard competition and will surf in round two on Thursday. Well, local draft players in candidate Master Kent Lane and Grandmaster Jack Francis will represent Barbados in the World Draft's Go As You Please qualifier next week in Antalya, Turkey. A number of the world's best players will be there from May 2nd to 5th for the qualifier, including past Go As You Please world champion Lubabalo Kondlo of South Africa, current three-move world champion Sergio Scarpetta of Italy, Grandmaster Igor Martinov of Germany, European champion Shane McCusker of Ireland, and the ex-three-move world champion Alex Moiseev of the USA. Lane, who has a rating of 46 in the world out of 244 players, told CBC Sports he will be seeking an international master norm as he already has gained a candidate master title.
I'm coming out against a lot of top players. I played most of them already. I draw with Jack Francis in the last tournament here in Barbados. I played the world champion Sergio Scarpetta in the Scottish Open, which I drew the first game. And unfortunately, lost the last game, but I'm looking to draw both games this time. And I'm feeling very, very confident that I'll have a good tournament. My preparations have been going good, and this, it depends on the day now to execute my mission.
A change of tactics is required if teams are to challenge current BFA Premier League frontrunners Weymouth Wales. That's according to former captain and former head coach of the Barbados national team, Ear Seeley. He was a guest on last night's Match Day Live from the 246 program on TV8, a monthly show dedicated to reviewing all the action from the BFA Premier League and also internationally. Wales are unbeaten this season, and after 9 matches, they look clear favourites to lift the title.
It's going to take something more than just trying to out-football Wales to beat Wales. You're going to have to make it physical. You're going to have to make it personal. You're going to have to get in their heads. You're going to have to take them off their game. It will not be a situation where you come and expect that you're going to out-football Wales and beat them. That certainly didn't seem to be happening. So if I was coaching, it certainly would be a different strategy towards beating Wales.
Another analyst on the show was Ronaldo Jokes, who is the technical director of Kickstart Rush Football Club and a former national player. He said the Champions Cup knockout competition, which started last weekend, will challenge teams who have grown accustomed to the world-class field at the BFA headquarters in Wildey. The Champions Cup is played in communities across the island on a home and away basis.
For the patrons, I know most of them prefer to see what we consider sexy football, where there's a lot of technical passing, moving, running with the ball, that kind of stuff. But the terrain makes it very difficult to execute such a tactic. So you're going to see a lot of direct play, a lot of physical play, as Ear mentioned, players who can commit to the aggression. And it could be a case of more so desire than anything else, especially in knockout football, where you just need one goal, regardless if you score one, two, or three. You just need to score one more goal than the opponent in order to progress.
In tonight's business, a slew of new banking services are coming to the region. Word of this came from Director of Corporate Communications at the CIBC First Caribbean International Bank, Deborah King. She says the focus would be on building, reconnecting with both retail and corporate clients, and a high-powered team from the bank's head office will leave Barbados next month at the start of the exercise. St. Kitts is the first stop.
There will be things like smart ABMs, digital client onboarding, and there are a couple of other innovations which we are in the process of introducing to the market across the region, and St. Kitts will be one of the early adopters of those services as well.
The bank official said they have an all-encompassing outreach program already in place to get the message across the Caribbean.
We have a campaign plan for the social media demonstrating the range of products and digital services that we have available, which we will be reacquainting the St. Kitts market with.
Retail prices in Barbados for January 2023 decreased by 0.1% when compared with the index for December 2022. But year-on-year movements within the index increased by 5.4%. Director of the Barbados Statistical Service, Aubrey Brown, looks at the numbers.
The index for January 2023 was 110.4. And that has changed from the index at January 2022, which was 104.7. So it would have increased by 5.4% over the year from January 2022 to January 2023.
That's our news. Do enjoy the rest of your evening.
Thanks for visiting us. Now, if you want to see more stories like this one, like and subscribe to our YouTube channel. And you can always go to cbc.bb for the latest news and current affairs.